thinning of the skin, an absolute frustrating problem, but it does have solutions. I'm giving you 8 solutions today in this video to thicken your dermis and get your skin back. And you guys are no different than everyone walking into my clinic every single day. What are my patients presenting with and what are you likely seeing? Well, number one, especially in this channel, is wrinkles, fine lines and wrinkles, because when you move, now as the skin thins, all it takes is a tiny bit of movement and boom, a flash of wrinkles. Where? Number one will be around and under the eyes. It's just natural. The number two area, and this is a frustrating one and often you don't get it until it's too late, is vertical lip lines, lines around the mouth. It's the end of my workday. This is a matcha, little less caffeine, of course, than coffee. But when I go to drink that, I'm going to purse my lips. Your lips hold food into your mouth. So you're always making that movement. The problem is, unless a great friend tells you, hey, you're getting vertical lip lines, you might want to think about prevention. You probably don't know what's happening because you don't do that in front of the mirror. Sticking with the eye, vessels and veins. This is half of my day in my clinic. Hey doc, I'm seeing this vessel underneath my eye that I just haven't seen before. Can you remove that vein or vessel? And that leads to redness, hollowness underneath the eyes. And it's partly lymphatic drainage, but it's because the skin is so thin here, like the back of the hand, you see the vessels. Does that make sense? A lot of you will say, my hands give away my age, because I know on this channel you guys are doing a great job of maintaining your face, then your neck, and then the back of the hands. It's because of the inherent thickness of the skin. And when you have thinner skin, like the under eyes, like the neck, and like the back of the hands, and you lose a little bit of dermal thickness, boom, you see the signs of aging. So it's the same thing in my clinic that I'm sure you're seeing. You also might be seeing scars. Yes, I have scars on my face, areas I've been sewn up. Many of us have. Or pimples where we had a deeper pimple, a furuncle, carbuncle, different things. And when we age, that gets deeper. It gets more noticeable. So by 35 for females and 40, they're gonna say, hey, I see these scars much more prominently if I only had thicker skin. Now, what's causing that? For me, in my clinic, the number one cause I'm seeing, because still, take the whole TikToker younger generation coming in. I see a lot of those, meaning 25, that's young to me. But still, 40 to 45 is a very common age. And what am I seeing? Estrogen loss. So the number one thing I see in clinic would be hormonal changes. And yes, it's happening around 35.
Check this graph out here. Here's the hormone levels. Here's the age. Here's 50. That's typically around perimenopause. Check this out. If I draw a line up from age 35, that's where it's all starting. And you can see there's estrogen loss. Look, a 35% reduction from age 35 to 50. That's absolutely huge in terms of symptomatology. At menopause, there's relatively high estrogen compared to progesterone, so they both play a role. We'll get into this in a minute.
But by 40, 45, it's so apparent that that is what I'm seeing. And as estrogen goes down, as hormones go down, so does the thickness of the skin. Number two, it's just normal with aging. Just by simply aging, by living life, you're gonna get thinning of the skin. The third cause of this is photo damage, and this is preventable. I am going to go through the solutions in a moment, but understand when you get photo damage to your skin, the machinery of collagen and hyaluronic acid production diminishes. The third common reason I see it is chronic inflammation, and this has to do with topically on the skin of how people are treating their skin, and it also has to do internally with their diet, their exercise, and their sleep. Chronic inflammation is not good for anything, particularly for the skin, and it will thin your skin. Second to last is stress. You're going to see stress everywhere on your body, but guaranteed on your skin, and it's something very preventable. And finally, the next determining factor is going to be color. Absolutely, the color of your skin determines what you should be doing. Skin type 1, 2, and 3. 1 is the whitest you can get, like albino, no pigment. 2 and 3. If you go to 4, I'm a skin type 4. 4, 5, and 6 are darker skin types. You're not going to get the thinning of the skin. Similarly, oily skin will typically be a thicker dermis. So what do you do? This is the crux of it. I'm going to go through 8 absolutely key important points, and I'm going to alternate between things you can do at home, skincare, and even a couple injectables. Number 1 is retinols. Now, I know there's a lot of FUD, fear, uncertainty, and doubt that's being put forth on YouTube, on social media about retinols. I can tell you undisputedly in my clinic, measuring over 20 years with special cameras, that people look younger, their skin improves, there's more integrity, more elasticity and collagen, and let's look at this.
Now let's check out retinols, a comparative study of the effects of retinol and retinoic acid, because I know a lot of you are on retinols, and I watch this at the end, let's see what it shows, but retinoic acid is kind of the gold standard and the one you all know about, but retinol is converted to retinoic acid. But let's look at this result. Okay, 4 weeks of retinoic acid and retinol treatments both increased, this is key, both increased epidermal thickness, here it is, upregulated genes for collagen type 1. Okay, that's what we see with injectables like Sculptra, and collagen type 3. With corresponding increases in procollagen 1 and 3. So even the procollagen and protein expression. I'm going to talk about proteins here in this video too. Facial image analysis showed significant reduction in facial wrinkles. So that's what you care about, is the wrinkles. Forget all the histology and the biochemistry. And that was at 12 weeks, which we always say, don't judge your retinol until the bottle's gone. That's what I say. Check, there's some important stuff in this conclusion, I believe, if I recall. Oh yeah. The results of the study demonstrate that topical application of retinol significantly affects both cellular and molecular properties of both epidermis and dermis. Here it is, as shown by skin biopsy. So once again, God loved these people. They allowed a skin biopsy, a piece of tissue to be taken that was then, of course, stained and placed underneath the microscope so we could see exactly what was happening. These results were confirmed by the significant facial anti-aging effect observed in the retinol study. It talks about where the, here it is here, although the magnitude, this is important for you guys because a lot of you are on retinols, although the magnitude tends to be smaller, retinol induces a similar change in skin histology and gene protein expression. So the retinol is a little bit less than the retinoic acid, but temper with this with the fact that you're not getting the level of inflammation that so many people get from retinoic acid. So I like retinaldehyde because that's right in the middle of these two. And that's exactly why I recommend and put retinaldehyde in my product. Of course, with avocado oil to decrease any inflammation that you might get. But retinaldehyde also, but more directly, converts to retinoic acid.
Number 2 is estrogen hormones. When we're talking estrogen, of course, for females, it's quite complex. Estrogen, progesterone, testosterone, and others. There's something called DHEA as well you can look into. But if you look at loss of estrogen and you look at skin and dermal thickness, there is a huge correlation. And there's no doubt why people are coming in around the age of 47 to 53 in droves to clinics with more lines and wrinkles that they can't manage at home. Now, hormone replacement, you're going to ask me, there's some controversy for sure. I did a complete video, it's about 50 minutes. I think every woman should watch that. There's no doubt, we now have bioidenticals, which were not included in the Women's Health Initiative study, and there are major flaws with that study. However, there's a group of women who absolutely should never go on estrogen, and there's a group that should, and then there's people in the middle. But understand this, we never, 100 years ago, women particularly lived to 52 to 54, somewhere in there. So now that the average age is above 80, and I was just in Japan, where it's pretty much 90 there, we're in uncharted territory. So there's not all the answers you want, but here's the thing, it's not just thinning the skin, it's what kind of lifestyle do you want? And I have patients come in that don't care, and they want to be more natural, and they don't want to go on anything. And for those next 50 years, from 50 to 100, they have a different lifestyle they want to live, and they would never go on hormones. Great. There's a group of people that want to live life to the fullest, that want to have great skin, sexual activity, hot flashes, flushes, hair growth, poor sleep, all those things can be related to hormones. So you need to watch that video. I'll put that at the end of this video and in the links below, but there's no question there's a correlation of hormones and dermal thickness. Now there are estrogen creams, you may ask, they haven't come to the forefront of aesthetics and available to the masses because there still could well be a cancer risk and estrogen absorption. So it's more of something that you get through a compounding pharmacy or through your medical clinic after evaluation to make sure you can have at least some unopposed estrogen somewhat safely in your system. That's complex. I can do a whole video on estrogen topicals if you want, but yes, you're not going to be able to go to your pharmacy or your drugstore aisle and just go pick that without a prescription. You certainly shouldn't be, in my opinion, but it's coming. Number three, let's go to a laser. We're gonna come back to some skincare and things you can do at home, but CO2 laser, many of you ask me, what do people love about CO2 laser? Well, it targets water, so it targets the surface of your skin. They love that they're brown spots, fine lines and wrinkles, they get glow back. So it helps all those things. What they don't like is the downtime. For me to do a CO2 laser, I really hammer the skin. I get rid and strip that protective barrier that everyone is trying to keep. But it's the healing process thereafter that gives you some tightening, that gets the browns. It will not get red so well, but it helps with texture, tones, pore, everything. But there is a 3-week recovery, and for some people, 6 to 8 weeks, because you're gonna get acne in your post-care. So it's an aggressive treatment, and it will not lift your face. It's not gonna affect the fat pads, the ligaments, and it won't give you that lifting, but it does really help the skin and improves dermal thickness. Let's go back to a topical. Alpha hydroxy acids, AHA cream. Again, there's some, not as much as retinols, but a lot of people like to instill some fear. Remember, I'm in clinical practice, I'm seeing patients every day. I'm answering to my patients. I'm not putting out a YouTube video every single day and not practicing what I preach in real life. I'm not answering to just comments below, but patients come in and sit in front of me and they want results and they give me feedback. You want, that's where you want to get your information. Despite that, let's also look at this study just as a backup so you see it's studied. But again, clinical practice is much more important to me than a study. You want to correlate clinical practice with a little bit of the study for long-term effects. Let's look at it.
Okay, here you go. Alpha hydroxy acids. No surprise to many of you, if you follow my channel, you know how important I believe these are on photo-aged skin. And if you look, alpha hydroxy acids have been reported to improve aging skin. But let's look at the results of this. Here you see patients applied a lotion containing 25% glycolic acid. Now, that's fairly strong. Or citric acid, those are both alpha hydroxy acids, to one forearm and a placebo lotion to the opposite forearm. And this placebo would have really no active in it, but of course they'd be massaging it in. So it's not a complete placebo. There is something happening to that side, but there's no active ingredient. Thickness, here's what we're talking about today. Thickness of forearm skin was measured throughout the study. Biopsy specimens from both forearms were processed for analysis at the end of the study. So pretty cool that they actually got biopsy, so people let them take a chunk of skin so they could study it. But check this out, phenomenal. Treatment with AHAs caused an approximate 25% increase in skin thickness. The epidermis was thicker and papillary dermal changes included increased skin thickness. There's the money for us. Increased acid mucopolysaccharides, improved quality. That's what you really care about. Elastic fibers, huge, and an increased density of collagen, colossal. No inflammation was evident. Exactly what we're looking for.
Next, let's talk Sculptra. Sculptra is poly-L-lactic acid. It's something we mixed with water and injected. So it's an injectable water with a collagen stimulator. Now, when we inject that, there's a little bead about 50 microns. It's like if you take a piece of paper, you drop a pen down, and it leaves a little tiny mark you can barely see with your eyes. That's the size of a Sculptra particle. It's in underneath the skin. You build your collagen type 1 and 3 around that. Nobody has to tell me, does that thicken your skin? I use it all day long for accordion lines in through here. Now, I don't want volume here. You don't want to widen the face, but I do want to thicken the dermis. So I use an 18:1, a diluted ratio, very commonly. And a lot of people like the hollow here. You know, buccal fat is trending. A lot of people don't have buccal fat removed, but they have a hollow here that accentuates the cheek, and they don't want to lose that nice contour. And I can use Sculptor Dilute just for skin tightening, of which it will be approved for soon, in my opinion, and also it's just approved for glow. So all these things I've been telling you for 15, 20 years, they're now being FDA approved. It's just that you need a trial to do it, and that trial was just recently done. I've been using it in cheeks for 15 years, and it was just now FDA approved. So keep in mind, just because you're learning about it now, we've done it for many years, the trials are coming so that the company can market it, make more money, and actually then train people to be better injectors, because you can train on things when they're FDA approved. You cannot as a company when they aren't. So it creates awareness and training, which is great. However, understand it's a collagen builder. I have many videos on it, but keep in mind, you'll hear again, here's the FUD, the fear, uncertainty, and doubt, especially plastic surgery. People only do surgery and don't do injectables. Many plastic surgeons do injectables too, but those who don't will tell you, hey, there's scar tissue being deposited. The number one cause of scar tissue in aesthetics is surgery, a facelift. And that's why getting a second one's harder. Deposition of collagen is a very difficult thing to quantify, and how collagen is put down in layers smoothly versus irregularly determines if it's scar tissue or collagen type 1 and 2. But absolutely, Sculptra works great. You can get a facelift easily after getting Sculptra. So don't buy into all the FUD. And if you want, I have videos interviewing people who do facelifts twice a day, 5-6 times a week, and they do it on their own Sculptra patients. So you can watch those interviews on this channel. Sculptra, keep that in mind. Next, we have exercise, and this is studied through biopsies, and this is in older people who they exercised after they took an initial biopsy, and after, I think it was about 2 months of exercise, 2 hours per week, if I recall, in that study, which is not much at all. They showed biopsy changes in the skin for dermal thickness increase. It does other things to the skin, and of course it's great for your body, but don't overlook exercise in not only preventing but reversing skin thinning. Now let's talk moisturizer. This is often overlooked. I'll tell you a story. In my clinic the other day, somebody came in and they're using a moisturizer. They don't like to use a lot of stuff, and they brought this in, so it's not working. I opened it up and I was like, this is perfume. It smelled, I guess, great. I don't like the smell of all that stuff. I like neutral. But the moisturizer, yeah, it had some good ingredients, but it was packed with preservatives, and of course it had scent in there. And that's not what you want. Sometimes with my Ultra Moisture, as an example, that's a product with a high organic content of oils. We have vitamin E in there, and rosehip oil, grapeseed oil. It's a great ultra moisturizing product, but we'll get a call back sometime, or we'll get on our website, someone complain that, hey, I'm not sure if it's right, if it's too old, it doesn't smell perfect. And I'll take that all day long because it's very effective. I actually like the smell of it. It's pretty neutral. If you're using it, comment below my Ultra Moisture if you like or don't like the smell. I love it, and it ends up, it's very neutral. I'm not a perfume kind of guy. So, but more importantly, what's good for your skin? A great moisturizer that does not irritate. Number one, doesn't inflame, but number two, decreases inflammation. And remember, if you're massaging it in, you're increasing blood flow. Increasing circulation creates thicker dermis, better skin, more nutrients. What about if you're willing to do an injectable, but you want it all natural? Now let's talk under eye here, because I mentioned a lot of people come in with thinning of the skin underneath the eye, and they can see veins because things are getting skin. Same with the things are getting thin. Same with the hands. We're moving to all natural platelet-rich fiber. Now why, I get asked all the time, why is this not more popular? We know it lasts long. People love it. You get glow. It helps with the fat pads. It helps reverse the ill effects of people who have face fat loss from devices and face fat loss from dissolving if they've had that. So why don't more people know about it and use it? Big pharma. So you're not going to hear about treatments that can't make money for somebody. And fillers make money for people. And of course, devices make great money. Some devices only cost $3,000 or $5,000 for the company to make, and they're selling them for $70,000. There's a lot of markups sometimes. So keep in mind, when you draw your own blood and you get an all natural product, people can't make hordes of money off it. You don't hear about it. I did start a locator, store.rajanimd.com/locate, so that people can find practices that carry my product, but often I've trained them and they are in my training circle. And of course, they offer platelet-rich vibrant. So that's my attempt to create awareness. And I'm, yes, for you global people, I've been in Europe training, go to congresses in Europe, Asia. It's becoming more popular, but you'll be very surprised to hear that countries, if you take Thailand, Vietnam, some of those countries, PRF, even though it's all natural, is not yet approved, but you can get fillers, Sculptors just being approved, biostimulators, pediothera, all that's approved, but all natural isn't. So you see, it can be nefarious at times, what gets approved and what doesn't. And you can trace it all back to probably money. You're going to want to watch now this video on ways you can naturally boost your own collagen so you can thicken your dermis, get glow. Stay tuned here. Keep your skin and body beautiful, healthy, and vibrant.